from Psalm 1. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, or stand in the way of sinners, or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever he does prospers. Not so the wicked. They are like chaff that the wind blows away. Therefore the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish.
Thank you. pray that you will take the word that comes from this morning, O God, and you will bless it, you will anoint it. I thank you, Lord, O God, that you will find an entrance into the hearts of men and women. I thank you that your word will be changed, O Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Thank you this morning that there's faith because of the word of God. Because faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God this morning. And we thank you, Lord God, that you've given us a measure of faith. And I thank Somebody say the church is back.
Church is back.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Just one thing that this whole thing has for us is that our work is not yet done.
Amen.
Our work is not yet done. As a church, our work is not yet done. We have a work to do. We have a race to run. Amen. There's a prize to be won.
Amen.
We are running for the prize.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Well, good morning, everybody.
Amen.
I trust that you are all well and blessed this morning.
Amen.
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 Praise God. And this morning, I want to share with you from the Gospel of St. Luke and the fifth chapter. The fifth chapter of Luke's Gospel. Praise God. Thank God as people of God.
Yes.
We are not alone. We are not destitute. We are not without hope. We thank God that we have hope in the Word of God. We thank God that our strength is in the Word of God. We thank God that everything that we need is found in His Word. Praise God. Jesus said in Luke's Gospel, chapter number 4, He says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God.
Yeah.
So I thank God this morning that we can live by a proceeding word. We live by a proceeding word, the word that comes out of the mouth of God Almighty. And I'm reading from verse number 1. So it was, as the multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, gold spoon, which was Simon's, and he asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. Jesus taught. He taught the word of God. He taught about the kingdom of God. People need to be taught about this kingdom. They need to be taught. People need to be taught. Were it not so, then Jesus would never have said what he said. Go baptizing all nations in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. Mm-hmm. All. The teaching of the word brings power to the people of God. Because it's in the word that we see the principles of this kingdom and how this kingdom operates. We are all kings and priests in this kingdom. But there's one king who sits upon the throne, and his word is the final authority. Our word never goes over his word. His word has authority over everything in our lives. And when he had stopped watching, he was teaching. And as he was teaching, there came a point where he stopped. And he spoke. You understand? He stopped and he spoke. And he said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." You see? It's only when you have faith that you can launch out. Many people are afraid to do what God has called them to do because they don't have word. Fear has grabbed a hold of them. Now Jesus was teaching the multitudes, and then he stops and he says to Simon, he says, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets," N-E-T-S, "for a catch." In other words, my teaching is not in vain. Because of my teaching, you're going to take this teaching now, and you're going to go out, and you're going to get results. There's one thing that I've come to learn in my walk with the Lord, is that His word never fails. Man will fail you. People will fail you. Society will fail you. Governments will fail you. Economies will fail you. Everything will fail you. But the word of God never fails. Can you say amen, somebody? His word never fails. His word will accomplish that exactly that for which it has been sent to accomplish. But Simon answered and said to Jesus, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing." You've tried in your own strength. You've tried in your own ability. And as long as you try it in your own strength and in your own ability, it will never work. You'll never get the results. Let's say you find many folks who say, "You know, this faith thing doesn't work because they've been doing it in their own strength." You say you have faith. What do you base that faith on? That faith you claim to have, what do you base it on? Is there a word that you are standing on? You can't just say, "I have faith." I mean, you find people, "I have faith that God will heal me. I have faith that God will heal me." And then you say, "Can you give me a scripture?" Then they say, "Yeah, Jesus healed everybody. The scripture is, 'By his stripes I was healed.'" Yeah. That's my word. Yeah. Come on, somebody. But something that I have read, meditated on, and grabbed a hold of, and made it my own, I claim it that way. I laid a claim on it. I made it mine. I
And that's what I'm standing on. In spite of the symptoms, by his stripes, I was healed.
Thank you.
And then you take that faith you have now, and you walk by faith. You can't be lying on the bed and say, I have faith in you. When are you going to rise up and say, by his stripes I was healed? Let I command you in the name of Jesus, comply to the word of God. Come and talk to me, somebody. If it's your stomach, you tell your stomach, comply to the word of God. Everything has to comply to the word of God. Are you hearing me, somebody? And you may say, I'm a pastor, that's something, that's something. No, you say comply, 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 comply to the word of God. And it will fall in line. Everything has to obey the word of God. Peter said, we toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net. At your word, I will let down the net. Jesus asked him to let down the nets, plural. Here Peter comes, and he says, I let down the net. Everybody had a net. Everybody had a net. Yet it's only Peter who says, I let down the net. What about the other disciples? What about the other disciples? You know, many times people get offended when people are giving testimonies, but those are the only people that are letting down their nets. Jesus said, let down your nets for a catch. You all have nets, but there's no catch. And that's a big catch. It's going to fill every net. Hallelujah. Peter says, I will let down the net at your word. And when they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and the net was breaking. The net broke because it couldn't hold what God had provided for them. There was provision. Come on, look at this. There were 12 disciples. 12 of them. If all 12 took their nets, don't you think they would have caught more fish than just that one net? That's why that net couldn't hold that number of fish, because it was meant for 12.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. When God does something for you, he doesn't do it just for you. He does it for a nation. When God saved you, he didn't save you so you could be Mr. or Mrs. Goody Two Shoes. He saved you so that you could get others saved. When God heals you, he doesn't heal you just, you know, so it can be you and you can carry on.
Possibility,
because the gospel that we we have received. It's a gospel of power. And that's the same power, that same ability is with you, it's upon you, it's within you to go forth and go and get others saved, to minister to others. But you know what's the problem? Too many folk water down the gospel and they're flirting and blending with the crowds. Jesus never flirted with anybody in his day. The people were transformed when they saw his life, they saw and they heard the words he spoke. They were transformed. What happened with the apostles? You find Paul, the apostle. His life was an example. Others followed. What example are we setting in our day? Are we just as afraid and confused as the rest of the world? Or are we rising up in faith and walking in faith and standing on the word of God? The Bible says, after having done all, stand. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Tell your neighbor, where's your mate? Ask your neighbor, where's your mate? Where's your mate? Everybody. There's a possibility to get something for everybody. It's not just specific people only. Come on, somebody. You see, Peter understood. They spent the whole night. They spent the whole night fishing. They caught nothing. And he says, but nevertheless, I've heard you speaking now. I have faith now. But at your word, I'm going to let down the net. And when he let down the net, there was a great number of fish. You know what happens, brothers and sisters? It's when you take the word, when you receive a word from God, and you lay a hold of it, you lay a claim on it. In other words, you take ownership of it. This word is mine. I receive it. I embrace it. I become one with it. That's the word, that engrafted word which says that word. That's the word that I allow. And as I take that word, I start speaking that word, and praying that word, and meditating on that word goes to work. Where there were no fish, there'll be fish. Oh Jesus, come on, somebody. When the prophet spoke to the woman, and he said, go and make for me first, for thus says the Lord. Come on, somebody. Thus says the Lord. Amen. Thus says the Lord. Come on, am I speaking to somebody this morning that will stand up and say, thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. Thus says the Lord. Now listen, come on. That very act of obedience to what Jesus had said, that was faith in action. In James' Gospel, chapter number 2, verse number 20. Do you want to know, O foolish man, that faith without works is dead? Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he offered Isaac his son on the altar? Do you see that faith was working together with his works, and by works faith was made perfect? So the works perfect your faith. As long as you're just claiming to have faith, but you're not working the faith, that faith is dead. It cannot produce. It's got to be active. Your action is what activates the faith. Your action is what activates it.
Yeah.
And every time you hear the word of God, faith is coming. Right now, you're hearing the word of God, faith is coming. So much so that you don't look at your circumstances. coward, but you face your circumstances. Eyeball to eyeball. And you speak the oracles of God. And you say, thus says the Lord my God.
Amen.
Thus says the Lord my God. Because I understand that He is my God. When my God speaks, there's power in what He speaks forth. My God spoke and said, let there be light. And there was light. My God spoke and He separated the waters. The waters above, the sky. The waters beneath, the seas. My God spoke to the ocean, and every fish of every kind came forth. My God spoke, and the trees came about. My God created what you see from nothing but purely just speech.
Yes, Lord, I love you.
Peter, do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. Do you love me? Yes, Lord, I love you. He said, Master, these three times you ask me. And these three times I'll be responded and told you, I love you. He said, feed my lambs. Feed my lambs. Feed my sheep. Brothers and sisters in Christ, no man is an island. In the day and age that we are living in, you want to have a word of encouragement and upliftment for somebody. Not when a brother or a sister has fallen that you go and celebrate about their fall. Shame on you! Feed them with the truth of the word. The word, yes, the truth may hurt, but it's done in love. Come on, somebody. The truth may hurt, but it's done in love. The book of Proverbs, chapter 11, verse number 30 tells us that he who wins souls is wise. If you want to be a wise person, if you want to be a winner, start winning souls. Start winning souls. Start winning souls. Start winning souls. The Lord is so concerned about soul winning in the day and age we are living in. He hasn't changed. You must purpose to be a soul winner. He didn't just save you so you could have your life all nice and put together and live nicely. No. God prospers you so that you can prosper others. Come on, somebody. God will make you. You see, when your heart is set on soul winning, you'll be amazed at how many opportunities God will bring to you. You'll find that when your heart is set on soul winning, God will even make promotion opportunities available for you. Just so that He can elevate you. And as He elevates you, you get elevated. Come on, He doesn't listen. He doesn't raise you so you can raise your standard of living. He raises you so you can stand and raise your standard of giving. Oh, that's quiet. He raises you so that you can raise your standard of giving. And the more you give, the more He blesses you. It's more blessed to give than to receive. Many folk forget that. Trust God. When God comes through, they forget about God. You find them in the right of trusting God. Every prayer meeting they get, every church service they get, and what if the door opens? The door to the church closes, and that thing now becomes the God in their lives. And it changes. Never allow those things to change your heart. Be purpose to be a soul winner. If you want to flow in the miraculous, if you want to see healings manifest through you, become a soul winner. Come on, somebody. Become a soul winner. Pray for the sick. Get them recovered. Come on. You may pray and you may say, now, Pastor, I didn't see anything happen. You know what happened? There were 10 lepers. Jesus only spoke the word. He said, go and show yourself to the priest as Moses commanded you. The Bible says, as they were growing, as they were growing. So it wasn't something that happened instantly. So you can pray for someone now, but you understand, what happens is you release a word of faith. And the word is what? The word is seed. And that seed, it takes time to grow. It takes time to manifest. But that word is settled there. And you find good time, the healing comes. So don't be discouraged when you pray or you release a word of healing and nothing happens. then something has happened. Because when you declare it was thus, says the Lord, be healed, be thou healed. Remember the leper? He came to Jesus, if you are willing, you can make me whole. Jesus said, I am willing, be thou cleansed. Immediately it was. Thus says the Lord. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So if you want to be a winner in life, start winning souls. If you want to be wise, start winning souls. Get your heart set on soul winning. It's not just a pastor's job. People think that, oh, that's the pastor's job. Really? Really? The fivefold ministry, apostle, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist, was given for the equipping of the saints, for the work of the ministry. Come on, we've all been called to win souls. You may say, you know, Pastor, I don't know how. Get someone invited to church. You've done your share. If you're not a type of one next week, if you've invited them, you've brought them to church, you've done your share. You've done your share. And there's a reward for that. There's great rewards for soul winning. Come on, somebody. This gospel has the power to transform lives. Has the power to transform lives. And the church, we the church, we're sitting with this power. But are we using it? Jesus, Peter said to Jesus, at your word, I will let down my net. At your word. In Matthew, I'm closing now. Matthew chapter 13. Jesus was speaking about the kingdom of God. And verse 47, Jesus says, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, every nation, every tribe, every tongue must come into this wonderful state of God's salvation. Salvation has been provided for every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, regardless of your age, regardless of your creed or of your race, salvation has been provided for everybody. So they threw this net into the sea and gathered some of every kind. It's amazing, watch this, some. It wasn't all, but some. Where it was full. There's a time, there's a fullness of time coming. There's a fullness of time coming. How full is your net? There's a fullness of time coming. When this net was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Jesus said to them, have you understood all these things? And they said to him, yes, Lord. Then he said to them, therefore every scribe instructed concerning the kingdom of heaven is like a householder who brings out of his treasure things new and old. How full is your net? Hallelujah. You know what the problem is? Is that we live in a day and age where the worship of self has killed the love of many. The worship of self, self-worship. People no longer regard others. It's the worship of self. And you find because of that, everything evil under the sun happens. People hate on each other. People kill each other. People withhold from each other. Strife, discord, all those things. Why? Self-worship. By this will you know that you are my disciples, that you love one another as I have loved you. Let love be the bond of perfection. Love. You see, when you love others, that's where soul winning comes in. But I don't care what it costs. I don't care what it takes. I'm going to see this person saved. I'm going to see this person saved. If I have to fast about it, if I have to pray about it, I don't care what it costs. I don't care what it takes. I'm going to see this person saved. You know, when you look at the early church, there's a time when the church is to come together and pray for souls. It's a time when people used to pray in their homes for souls. When last did you pray for souls? When last? Because most people nowadays, the only thing they pray, Lord, bless me, bless my dog, bless my cat, bless us. But you forget. You know the next door neighbor living next to you, start there. You know, you're living next to that person. I don't live there, but you live there. You know what that person is going through. You know that. But you know what people do? They think they know everything about the person's life. Therefore they judge the person. But you don't know, the person is the way they are. But you don't know the thing that person is going through. Why don't you pray for your neighbor? Pray for them. Many times your neighbors tell you about times of hardship they're going through. Maybe you might find your neighbor even comes to about a cup of sugar. Most often we find people because the hearts of God so cold, hey, this person's always coming to borrow. When did you ever say, can I pray with you? I'm going to pray with you, and God's going to turn this thing around, because I know in the word of God, there was a man of God who said, thus says the Lord, for the entire duration of this sermon, the flower, your crude of oil, will not cease. I'm standing on that word. It's in my Bible, and I'm trusting God to see this word manifested in your life. It starts there. It starts at home. Come on, somebody. It starts at home. Start praying for your neighbor, the people you work with. You see they go through challenges. When last did you pray for them? You see, what you put out for others is the net that catches your harvest. Oh, Jesus, really good. What you throw out for others is the net that connects with your harvest and brings it close to you. Live more for others. And less for ourselves. That is what this word was all about. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, He did not come to be served. He came to serve. And He said, what I've done for you, do for others too. As I've washed your feet, so you ought to wash each other's feet. The only time we find the people wash each other's feet is at Easter. Because they know that's what Jesus did. On the night when He was betrayed, that's what He did. We should be washing each other's feet daily. Come on, somebody. You know, there were even times when somebody would come and visit. They would have a bowl there with water, where the person would wash their feet. Because it would refresh them.
Yeah.
That's why the Bible says, He who refreshes others will himself be refreshed. Abraham was sitting under the trees and marveling at the door of his tent. He saw three men. Bid them come in, let me wash your feet. Let me get something for you to eat. Please don't go on the journey until you've been refreshed. That's why the writer of Hebrews admonishes us and says, do not neglect to entertain strangers, for some have thereby entertained angels unawares. If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me drink, you would ask and He would give you living waters that you would thirst no more. How many angelic encounters we miss purely by focusing on ourselves? The person that you just engaged with, that could have been an angel. That's alright. That could be an angel. You don't know. Some have entertained angels on the ways. Yet you pray and you think, oh, the angel will come or see the light. No. The angel will come as a complete stranger that you don't even know. You with me?
Yeah.
Come on, somebody. Somebody said, I'm going to get my leg full. I'm going to get my leg full. Yeah. That's what this kingdom is about. You find, as you read on, in that portion of scripture, I've just shared with you from Luke 5, you find that Peter even repents. He says, depart from me, for I'm a good man. I'm not good enough. Jesus says, from now on, you will be fishers of men. You will catch bigger fish. What Jesus is saying there, greater works than these are you going to do. Greater works. There's a greater work for you to do. Come on, somebody. There's a greater work for you to do. There's great things for you to accomplish. If you read the scriptures, you find time after time after time, every person that walked with God, God did great and mighty things in their lives. And as you walk with God, those great and mighty things will be something, not that you read about, but something that you experience firsthand. That will be a daily bread. It will be a part of your life. Never forget that we are a supernatural class of people. We serve a supernatural God. So I'm not going to go by what I see, what I hear, what I feel. I'm going to go by thus says the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. I trust you at something this morning. Amen. Praise God. Now as we close, I'm going to call Sister Tracy, she's going to come and do the offering. And I just want to make it clear, as we move to level one, we will still continue the precautions that we've put in place in the church. Amen?
Amen.
We will still continue with that. And we will, next week, we will bring more chairs, we'll get more chairs into the facility, but there will still be the maintaining of social distancing.
Yeah.
Amen. So what will happen is you enter as you normally enter, sanitize your hand, get your temperature checked, and you come to service. At the end of service, you put your envelope, your tithe offerings, and your tithe offering box there, and then you sanitize your hand, and you leave your home.
Okay.
You will still maintain that. Amen. Hallelujah. So we still maintain that. And I must say, we are thankful to God. We're truly thankful that God has kept us. God has preserved us. I thank God for that. I thank God for that. And some of you don't remember when we prayed, even on the group, when we shared the messages, even when we prayed, before that was from the beginning of the pandemic, and we still continue. I said, Lord, I refuse to bury anybody to this pandemic from our church. I refuse it. We had one of our members in our church, 78 years old, with comorbidities. It was tested positive. And that person recovered fully. Fully.
Thank you.
can open up the Bibles to Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. Okay, it says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that they may be food in my house. And try me now in this, says the Lord of hosts. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that they will not be room enough to receive it. Okay, in this passage, the Lord presents us with a challenge. He says to bring our tithes to his house and present them before him. But what follows is a challenge, he says. Try me now in this. If I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing, they will not be room enough to receive it. God is asking us to have faith in his word. He says to try me and to see what I can do with your gift. It is God's desire to not only bless us, but to bless us past the point of having room enough to receive it. But how do we access this blessing by faith? By believing that he can and will do what he says in his word. If we choose to obey and to trust in his word and accept his challenge, he will prove his word faithfully every time. Church, I want to encourage you today to put God to the test in your finances and let him be Lord over your money. By serving and tithing, you are giving God the right to watch over your money and investments that no thief can steal from you. Your finances will be protected. Put God first and see what he will do with the 10% that you give him. Yeah. Let us say this confession. Father, today I bring my tithe and my gift into your storehouse. I believe in your word where it says that you will open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing. I stand on it. I have faith in it. And I act on my faith today. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, I just want to give a testimony.
Amen.
Okay. During the whole lockdown, as we all know, most of our salaries were cut. I'm sure for most of the people that are sitting here. And, you know, during the whole 6 months, I paid faithfully. My whole time. I didn't cut my tithe because my salary was cut. Okay? And although it was difficult, but I still gave faithfully. And to this day, it's as if my salary has not been cut at all. So please, even if the lockdown continues or jobs do get, you know, retrenched and people lose a job, please pay your tithes faithfully. God sees your heart.
That's right.
He hears your prayer and he sees your heart.
Amen.
So please let us give faithfully and you will receive abundantly.
Amen.
Now bless the Lord. Amen. Let me stand to release the final blessing. Jesus, just lift up your hands. In the name of Jesus. Jesus, we love you. Bless you. Praise you. Worship you. Exalt you, Lord Jesus. We declare that you are Lord of all. Declare your purpose. Thank you that you make all things new. Thank you that you restore us and revive us. Thank you that you refresh us by your word. sweet fellowship of the Holy Ghost will bless and abide with each and every one of us, both now and forevermore. I pray, Lord, to bless your people. Pray to prosper them and keep them. Let them be well with them. And God, may they prosper even as their souls prosper. That they may be in good health. That the length of days, O God, you satisfy them. Pray, O Lord God, for all our senior folk. Pray that you will renew their youth as the eagles in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, to bless your people, that you keep them under your loving care. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Lord bless you and keep you, cause his face to shine upon you. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, be with you both now and forevermore. In Jesus' wondrous name. And the people of God say, amen, 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 amen. Come on, someone say amen.
Amen.
So be it, so be it, so be it, so be it. In the name of Jesus, I just feel it in my spirit. I have to pray for some folks. Lift up your hands. In the name of Jesus, and whatever is our prayer, this is what God is pressing upon my heart. And he lets you, whoever takes to you, you receive it by faith right now. You receive it by faith because you serve a miracle-working God. Yes, they may say that we cannot touch, we cannot lay
final day, he said to my other brother William, "You must pray for me. I'm gonna die." Like I said, he was backslidden and he laid his hand on his foot and the Lord healed him and he gave his life to Christ.
Thank you.